cowboy western movies of the 1950s had very simple plots and predictable conclusions. The heroes wore white hats, smiled always, and sang. And the villains wore black hats and chewing tobacco and had an evil smirk. The good guys always won, evil overcome, the thief caught. And no matter how difficult the place that the hero faced, you know that in the end, justice would triumph, and peace would once again prevail on the frontier. But real life is not that simple or clear-cut. Real life is sometimes messy, and seems that evil overcomes good, and suffering over peace. So, what kind of story does Jesus tell in this morning's gospel? The shifty-eyed steward swindles his master's money, and he manipulates his employer's funds for himself. He's found out and finds a way out. The anti-hero of the gospel narrative was facing a crisis, the loss of his income, and he did something. He did something. He didn't just let things happen. Now, the Lord was not condoning who he was or what he did. No, but through the story, the Lord was challenging those who followed him to face the many crises of life with the wisdom and the life example that leaped from the way of Jesus. When Jesus faced mockery of the scribes and Pharisees, the misunderstanding of his friends and of his family, when rejected and betrayed, he lived the way he invited his followers. He lived the conviction that God was always present, and in the end, would triumph. One reality unites all of us and each of us. We will all experience suffering and trials at different times and in different ways. And at times we might feel that we're facing a brick wall where there's no escape. Take, for example, family life, with its inevitable changes, if only growing older. And sometimes the glow of early love between husband and wife dwarfs into routine, and many times distancing. And then there are children, certainly a joy. But as time marches on, disappointments of all kinds, conflict, lack of warmth, not speaking on the same level of communication, a growing lack of unity. And the parable challenges us, well, do something. Don't let commitments and relationships die or even unravel. Now, if this strikes a chord in you or our family members, then you, better than anyone from the outside, know what you must do. You can find a way, even as that shifty steward found a way. But you have to seek it out. It doesn't just happen. And nothing happens if somehow there's just silence or not facing the root problems that every family faces in the unfolding of life. And then there are the experiences particular to each of us in different ways of health, extended family, jobs, with all the challenges they bring for peace and unity. Do something. Ask questions. What might arrive? What do I want life to be? And then the very hard question, what should I do with me to strengthen things out? I imagine Jesus in prayer went to the Holy Spirit to enlighten and strengthen him in the difficulties that he faced. So must we. Do something. The challenges of life don't just find an answer in silence. Some among us are facing the crisis of faith, perhaps even wondering why they're here. That too is inevitable in our society. All around us, family, friends, co-workers, who for one reason or another no longer have a center where God is the source and destiny of life, where God can be thanked, where God can be trusted, where Jesus is the point of reference, Jesus who says that he's the way, the truth, and the life. The way he lived his life is the way that's supposed to enlighten us. It just isn't there. It's not something distant from us. For he understood and faced the very same problems and the joys that you and I have. But we must go to him in prayer and reflection if truly he will be our way and truth and life. And perhaps the problem that we have is the pilgrim, limited, sometimes sinful community of faith. Sometimes that's the stumbling block. Many have taken a walk. You know them, and I know them. So if that's the way things are, like a conniving consciousness book of the gospel, do something. Talk it over with a person of faith who has weathered the storms and stayed faithful, and is joyous in following the way of the Lord. Search faith out with one of the parish staffs. That's why we're here. We have been trained to somehow understand how the gospel message connects with the realities of life. And we have an understanding, again, of the way in which Scripture is put together. It's not a word that's easily understood. We're not the kind of people who think that you just read the word and you got it. No, it's like any scientific understanding. You have to sort it out, you have to piece it out. You have to connect it together. And so if you're having problems with faith and wondering why you're bothered, do something. Don't let this vital relationship with the Lord and with the community of faith just die and wither. Who can deny the many crises we face as a nation? Remembering as we did last week, 9/11, and then the bombing in Saudi Arabia, and that's just a couple of things. Oh yes, we're disciples of Jesus, but the temptation is to lash out in vengeance, if only in our minds. The temptation is to become like a terrorist. There are many other crises in our society, many crises which we don't experience because we're middle class people. But if we really face the crisis at the poor now, I mean the really poor, with all the consequences that poverty has, relating to the education of children, relating to living in communities where there is peace, relating to all the issues that are consequent of being a have-not in our world. We say we're a community, but I think very often people of our society in America, we're a community where crises happen that affect us. Oh, when a war came, all of a sudden we're a community. And we wanted everybody to participate. Oh, come on in. And so then we welcome the poor and the have-nots. But if we truly are a community, then we do something about the crises that people face in our society. And if we look up Matthew 25, what you do to the least, you do to me. We have to have that central in our life. That's another point of the gospel message this morning. Luke, all the way through the gospel of Luke, is about the haves and the have-nots. And the requirement of the haves to reach out and do something about the poverty that exists in the world then and now. The theme of Christ's life is to give himself for the life of the world, we say. So does he invite us to live. God would not have us be passive if we face crises in our personal lives, in the trials of nation and church. Do something, the Lord shouts out, as he praises the conniving true steward in today's gospel. Do something to bring healing and peace to family, to the nation, to the church and to ourselves.